Thanks, Nick.
Oh, yes. Sorry, it is being this meeting is also being recorded as a disclosure.
Thanks, Nick. I hope this is not going to be too meandering because I put this together relatively quickly. There's not a lot of new science. You'll hear that at the Packard Center in a couple of weeks about what's going on. It's really more almost a historical look in time, back in time, about what we've done in ALS. And quite honestly, everything that we've done in ALS to discover drugs and model systems is really paralleled or mimics the same kinds of things that have gone on in Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's and actually many other neurologic diseases, actually many medical diseases in general. And so I'm going to walk through that because I know looking at the list of you, there's a variety of people with different experiences. Some early career want to think about how you discover drugs or intervention for patients. And then at the other end, there are potential great critics of what I'm going to speak about because John Dunlap's online. John has a long history in actual pharma. Now I'm going to end a little bit at the end of the talk talking about the transition between us as academic researchers and intersections with pharma, what it really takes to develop a drug. Okay, oops, with that introduction. This is actually the entire drug discovery process that goes on. All of us live in this, most of us in academics live in this gray box, research and development. What is the actual pathway? I'm going to use the word a ton tonight, this morning, that underlies the disease, in this case, ALS, but it could be any neurologic disease. And that obviously means what's the target of an eventual future drug, your target of identification. The rest of the slide usually is handled by pharma. Once you have a target, compound screening, finding the molecules, identifying the lead molecule, then doing preclinical. Now, this title of my talk is preclinical studies, but that's really in the realm of research and development, meaning early using models of disease to find the targets. Once you actually have a drug, there are many preclinical studies that are done to see how is the drug handled by an animal, whatever size, whether it's a mouse or a goat. The in vitro studies, in vivo studies about metabolism, and then eventually clinical trials, phase one trials, phase two trials, which is very much about much of the lecture series that Nick has put together for all of you. And then after review and approval, evaluation, manufacturing, post-approval monitoring. We're not touching any of this. You've actually heard a little bit about some of this from different people over the last few months that Nick's brought in. And no doubt you'll hear more about this. We're going to focus on this very first box because none of this happens. The rest of this doesn't happen if you don't really have a target. And although I didn't put a slide in here, the vast majority of targets that we discover for patients with neurologic disease come from academics. I don't want to insult industry, but the vast majority of industry research is based on what we first find as a target. So it's up to us to do a good job at finding those initial targets. By the way, that's not to say occasionally industry doesn't look for a target. So I'll throw spears occasionally. For example, the Genentech trial of DLK kinase inhibitor, that was done completely within Genentech. Oh, that was a complete failure. That was a highly toxic pathway. That said, we as academics often don't know if a pathway ultimately would be toxic. So I'm jumping ahead a bit here. So fundamentally, you need to identify the pathways that underlie a disease. And many of you know we've had failure after failure after failure in ALS, in part because we've really not done a thorough job to discover the pathway and ascertain whether that pathway is actually present in patients. And at the end of the talk, I'll talk about, if I have time, I'll talk about a new way to do that in terms of sporadic disease. So one, we really need to identify a relevant disease pathway. In years ago, prior to transgenic models, and we'll talk about models in just a few moments, this was heavily based on human data, actually, as it should be. It's our patients, not a mouse that we care about, not a fly that we care about, not a fish that we care about. It's our patients. And so this was often based on autopsy material. And historically, we can go back in time and say some of the first examples actually were about astrocytes and glutamate transporters, where defects were found first in humans, later in mouse models, that astrocytes had a defect. That was a potential pathway. Years later, the E2 story dates back to the early 90s. By mid-2000s, we had discovered through the work of John Trojanowski and Virginia Lee, initial work by them, that TDP-43, tRDNA binding protein, TDP-43, was an abnormal pathology, which we now know is present in almost all sporadic, not necessarily all familial forms of the disease, but certainly all sporadic as a pathology. And many of you also know we've spent decades really since that discovery trying to understand the biology of TDP-43, which I won't talk a lot about today, but it's an example of a human-based pathway or clue that was first discovered. Another in sort of both human and rodents were stress animals, a hot area, and I'll end by talking a little bit more about that. Now, the cons of this starting point is that it's end-stage disease. You don't know what really started that pathway off. If glutamate transporters are abnormal in a human, well, was that like 3 weeks before the patient died? Was it when they were 10 years of age? We don't really know that. And postmortem tissue suffers from lots of other variables that model systems don't necessarily have. Antemortem hypoxia in ALS, all patients before they die have horrible and prolonged hypoxia. That's certainly going to change molecular events that you look at when you look at postmortem brain. Abnormal nutrition, patients are going to be deprived of good nutrition. These are things you can't necessarily control for. You can have controls. You can have people who died of a heart attack, but that's not really the right control. It ought to be other patients that have died of similar antemortem injury, such as hypoxia, as an example, nutrition, if you're going to make sort of molecular biochemical comparisons. Unfortunately, this is often not done. More often than not, an autopsy study is comparing ALS to someone who died of a heart attack. Not the right control. You really want other diseases that suffer from those same common variables to rule out those variables as an underlying event. This is why we often ask as reviewers, when someone says, I'm studying ALS, and look, I've had a specific pathway in ALS, well, did you look at Parkinson's or Huntington's or Alzheimer's or someone else who had maybe chronic hypoxia, just as a comparison? So autopsy is the first sort of starting point, or can be, in pathway identification. We can then move to biofluids, CSF, blood, and urine. We know that a lot of inflammatory pathways can be detected in proteins. People have been using neurofilament, not really a pathway, more of a marker of injury. By the way, I'm going to be throwing out a lot of opinions. You may disagree with me in my interpretations. Feel free to. And actually, historically, biofluids, other than CSF, are actually not that useful. They're not really telling you what's going on in the brain. They can be useful for biomarkers of drug interactions, or maybe your drug working. They're not historically, if we look back in time, they've not been that valuable in identifying the true pathway that initiated a disease injury. More recently, there's been a lot of focus on inflammatory markers, and we know inflammation occurs in the brain, certainly at end stage, and I'll talk about temporal relationships. Finally, in the way of human modeling, there's human imaging. You can now look at evidence of inflammation with markers of microglial activation, or crude markers of microglial activation, such as TSPO. Naza Matazi, before he left MGH, had done a series of studies, as well as a few other groups, showing you can detect inflammation in patients in life. We don't really have a temporal relationship as to when these events begin, but it's another way of beginning to identify active pathways. And these kinds of markers also give you tools, eventually when you have drugs, to go back to patients, either to pick the patients, for example, out of inflammation, or to show your drugs working in vivo by showing a loss of these inflammatory markers by PET ligands. We all know that PET studies are challenging in patients. Nevertheless, it is one tool. There may be in the future TDP-43 PET ligands. We know that multiple labs are trying to develop that, quite a challenge, but these are tools that can be used to identify pathways. Okay, so that's human data. Since 1995, there's been a huge shift, quite honestly, a shift almost away from human data to various preclinical non-human models. And these include originally the mouse model, first made by Mark Gurney in 1995, then right after that, Phil Wong and others, actually here at Hopkins, Don Cleveland when he was here at Hopkins, Don Price, Sam Sodia, Dave Borchell, all were part of this great consortium to build some of the new mouse models. And now there've been many mouse models built on ALS gene mutations, first starting with SOD1, but many other gene mutations have been made. They don't all get disease. That disease doesn't all look like humans, and we'll get to that in a second, but it's been a tool because one of the great values of that tool is you can kill the mouse before death and begin to analyze the development of a pathway. Again, human end stage, mouse, if it's done properly, you'd compare mouse to human. Does the mouse reveal the same things you have in human? Flies are tools. Yeast have been tools, zebrafish have been tools, but many of you may know these are great tools. So before I get to the cons, one of the reasons these are great tools, and I say this a lot in some of my talks, is that if you live in the middle of wherever, where there's no other medical center, you can buy the mice from Jackson Labs and you can study ALS without having access to patients. And this has been a huge value in having mouse models, not just because it's easy to use, but you distribute the research population that gets involved in ALS research by having these tools. That's been valuable. The downside is that people often haven't compared the mouse back to human to know if those pathways are relevant. And a huge downside is none of these are endogenous expressions, for the most part, none of these are endogenous expressions of a human gene. They're overexpression systems, which no patient really has. There can be poor protein homology in pathways between mice, flies, or yeast, et cetera, in humans. And so there may not be protein equivalents. And this will depend upon the pathway you decide to investigate. In our own lab, we found major changes in, for example, nuclear pore biology by a talented postdoc, Alyssa Coyne, but it turns out some of those proteins aren't even present in flies. So there can be a mismatch. That doesn't mean these models aren't valuable, but you have to go into these experiments with wide eyes, knowing there are major caveats before you jump to assume what you find in these models is absolutely relevant to patients. More recently, to sort of add to the model system, but getting more simplistic, are the human models. This actually began a long time ago with immortalized motor neuron lines. These are immortalized. Don't ever think of using them. They're crap. They were used years ago before we had true endogenous cells, and the immortalized motor neuron lines are just not worth even thinking about, but they were years ago. Today, we have, as many of you know, induced pluripotent cells, and I'll end my talk talking a little bit more about that. These have endogenous expression of the human genes. You can make them from sporadic patients. More recently, groups like Michael Ward are able to generate specific mutations in a common single set of lines. So there's an identical background against the multiple mutations. These are CRISPR generated. So you have this really endogenous tool. Of course, the downside is this is not going to be a complex nervous system, but if you're studying cell biology of a pathway, you may not need cell-cell interactions. Really depends upon the question you're trying to identify. Trying to study ER stress in a given cell, nuclear biology, mitochondrial biology, you don't really necessarily need to have a mouse to do that. You really want endogenous systems, again, my opinion. Of course, now with iPS cells, you can generate all the different cell types, motor neurons, cortical neurons, spinal neurons, dopamine neurons, things that may not be as relevant to ALS. You can develop astrocytes that are even regional. You can develop oligodendroglia, microglia. And now people are beginning to put these cultures together and either mix and match, mixing them together, or using organoid-like systems. Now, there are confounding issues in these. One, the cultures. The pathogenic cascade may not be there the day you make that motor neuron. In fact, lessons we've learned in our own lab and published recently by Alyssa is that it takes sometimes weeks to develop the actual pathogenic cascade that you see. The cells may be alive, look like motor neurons, but the pathogenic event, the loss of motor neurons, the development of TDP43 mislocalization takes time, which is actually not unreasonable. The type, the composition of the cell from plate to plate may vary. The method used to generate iPS cells may vary from lab to lab. It's a little bit like if you have mice with different genetic backgrounds, not quite the same experiment. The way the labs generate those cultures ideally will be uniform across the entire world of ALS research, not the case. There are different protocols. When we began our research using iPS years ago, it took 80, 90 days to develop motor neurons. Now we do it in 12 days. So we've changed that. All of that affects either assay reproducibility, development of pathogenic cascade. These are just variables you need to know when you think about these systems and you compare your research to another system. And lastly, before I move on, is the number of lines. Remember when you work with iPS cells, let's go back. A mouse model, fly model, one gene, they're all genetically identical, sort of. C57 black, yeah, they're all genetically identical. But human iPS lines, it's like looking at individual patients. So you can't look at two lines. That's like looking at two ALS patients. No real research of any value looks at an N of two. These are people. You need to think about an N that's reproducible and that reflects the genetic variability of true humans. Even C9 patients are different. In my clinic, C9 patients come from all racial backgrounds, and therefore you need that variability in your experiments. You need at least 5 to 15 IPS lines, especially if you're studying sporadic ALS, to represent the individuality. And years ago, that was not available. Yeah, that's no excuse today. They're all available through various sources. If you don't know them, you can certainly feel free to email me, though I'll talk about one at the end. Finally, they're organoids. Organoids are sort of the new generation of iPS cells. iPS cells are sort of a 2D protocol. Organoids now, spinal, cortical. They do take months to form, and they're not truly, although people call them organs, yeah, they're not truly organs. Generally, they don't have oligodendroglia. Well, the brain has oligodendroglia, and they're quite necessary. Or they haven't fully developed astrocyte populations. A colleague of mine years ago, when they first came out with cortical organoids, we went to them because we were interested in astrocytes. We said, geez, can we study them? You've got beautiful layers of neurons. It's fantastic. We're interested in layer biology. And they said, well, they don't have astrocytes. Yeah, that's not an organ. It may have a geometric distribution, but that's not an organ. So they're not, although they're human, they may not truly represent, as people think, the actual circuits, but they are a more complex interaction than a standard IPS perforation. And by the way, they also have a great degree of variability, probably more than standard 2D IPS preps. Okay, mouse models since 1995 really have been the most common tool we use in preclinical research. They often mimic very important elements of human ALS. They have death of motor neurons. By definition, they have to have death of motor neurons. But it turns out they don't often have death of all motor neurons. The early models had mostly death of spinal motor neurons, not cortical. A patient without cortical motor neuron death is not ALS. It may be progressive muscular atrophy. It might be spinal muscular atrophy. It is not ALS, true ALS. They certainly have the inflammation, or many of the models that we see in patients. And they have elements, as I said, of human pathology. They have death of motor neurons, that some may have death of cortical motor neurons. Again, it varies from model to model, and a good model needs a full evaluation. And you actually do want to see death of even frontal neurons, because we now know that 50% of ALS patients have dementia, a mild dementia, some with a severe dementia. So it's okay to have that. But in reality, if you stand back, the pathology of even the mouse models truly completely mimics human disease. When the SOD1 mouse were made by Phil and Mark Gurney, these are fantastic, beautiful degeneration of spinal motor neurons, atrophy of muscles, weakness, and eventually death. But if you looked at the pathology, there was massive vacuolization in the G93A mouse. That doesn't happen in patients. In the G85R mouse made by Lucy Broom, massive protein aggregates. Yeah, that doesn't really happen in patients, not at that level. So there's no question they're useful, but don't falsely assume they're a perfect model of humans. They're not. Most importantly, that now I've said a bunch of negatives, these are really useful tools. And keep in mind, there are multiple different mouse models. There's the PMN, there's a profilin mouse, there's the SOD1 mouse, they're the BAC-C9 mice, which have pathology, but no neurodegeneration. If you find a pathway in a mouse model, you really want to do your best to validate it in human tissue. So the other part of pathways that you're thinking about is when we see patients, remember, we're seeing patients at the latter to end stage of disease. This is not like Alzheimer's disease where you can see patients really early in disease. The time from clinical disease onset to the time of diagnosis is often and most commonly worldwide 1 year. And in a sporadic patient, you can't get earlier because they haven't developed symptoms. In a familial patient, in the few that we have, you can look earlier through a variety of methods, clinical methods. And there have been a number of studies done. And there's a very large study through Michael Benatar, who lectured to all of you not that long ago, where he's run a program looking at familial ALS patients presymptomatically. But most of ALS is sporadic. You can't really get beyond the disease onset. Nevertheless, when we think of the disease, we can think of what are the very early pathways and what's late in the disease. And this sort of cartoon gives you a sense of that. What is the early disease trigger? Again, this is important as you think about your pathway and eventual human intervention. So of course we know gene mutations, they're the trigger. It's the mutation that starts. Whether it triggers it at birth or triggers it because of some other insults after birth, we don't know. Could be that the mutation's there and at 10 years of age, some trauma sort of starts off a cascade because of a little CNS inflammation because of the local trauma. It's actually known that local trauma to a limb can induce local changes in the spinal cord. So there can be environmental stressors that add to the initial trigger. Gene mutations, again, are thought to be the initiator. Aging can add to that system. If there's a cell not working quite perfectly, I'm hand waving here what that means, aging with progressive loss of function. So for example, one of the well-described changes in aging is our increasing defects in nuclear pore function. Not enough to kill the cell, but you compound that with another, we'll call it oligogenic, other defects, you now have a potential trigger, which would probably be a little later in disease. So in various injuries can make a cell more sensitive to a stressor. For example, glial loss function, one of the things that we covered many years ago, is that a late event or is that very early? Does the glial loss of function then stress the motor neuron to then cause this degeneration? Late events we're much more familiar with. We know inflammation is almost certainly a relatively late event. We can see it in patients. We can reliably see it. We don't see it in various mouse models early on. Glutamate toxicity, almost certainly a relatively late event. And the recent interest, although, for example, Aaron Gittler's a beautiful paper on P53, we've actually known about programmed cell death years ago, way back in the late 1990s, 2000s, that multiple apoptotic pathways are active, can be activated, at least in our models. But these are truly late events that, like, many hours before the cell dies and before the patient dies. So these are not early events in any way. So these late events are proximal to the actual loss of neurons. Now, loss of neurons. And by the way, that doesn't mean a late event is still not an intervention event. It is, but knowing where these events lie can be important as you think about molecular interventions. And they're certainly important as we think about drug therapies. Now, before I leave the slide, I'll point out that we used to think that gene mutations, yeah, they're interesting. We have great molecular tools, but would it really affect patients? Because by the time that mutation began triggering disease at 10 years of age, by the time you see a patient at 50, does it matter anymore? Or all of these other pathways are now activated and they're driving the course of disease. We know that's not true because of the recent gene therapy studies in SOD1 patients, where we clearly saw an effect. And I'll get to those studies in just a few minutes. So there are examples of therapies in relation to disease course. Again, disease initiators, early disease, gene mutations, SOD1, C9orf, there are therapies, and I'll repeat that a little later. We're intervening now at disease initiating events. Disease propagators, we don't really know much about these. We can hand wave about what we think they could be. Stress granule biology, protein aggregation, various cellular networks are potential disease propagators. Chronic excitability, glial connectivity, beautiful work by Nick on connexins, astroglial connexins, glial dysfunction, oligodendroglial dysfunction, lack of metabolic support. And by the way, these are just a few, the ones I'm more familiar with, but this list could go on and on. DNA damage has come up as evidence of disease. We don't really know where they are in relation to disease, but there's no question there's evidence, long evidence, more recent studies, but actually older studies on DNA damage. Now, late disease therapies partly focus, and again, this is my opinion, on, for example, inflammation. And we know there's an enormous amount, if you haven't heard, there have been already some lectures about some of the therapies ongoing right now, complement pathways, microglial inhibition. There are multiple ways in which we can intervene in inflammation. And these are almost certainly very late events. That doesn't mean they're not going to be effective. We already know that glutamate toxicity is a late event and really is all not a very powerful drug, yet had an impact on the progression of disease. And that's, as I show here, glutamate toxicity. And in oxidative stress, again, Endarvone, not entirely sure how it works. Almost certainly oxidative stress is a relatively late event and has efficacy. So these pathways can have impact. One of the things we don't know is what's the nature of the contribution at the time you see a patient. So this is a beautiful slide by the group out of Belgium from a Nature review. And it shows data largely from SOD1 mouse and mouse studies, but also from human studies, multiple different pathways that are activated from these studies that are also potential targets for interventions. So this all reflects, this entire schema reflects largely preclinical work. And so, for example, I mentioned oligodendroglial dysfunction that came out of here, astroglial dysfunction, nuclear pore, DNA damage, axon transport. All of these are different pathways. What we actually never know in a patient is, gee, is oligodendroglial degeneration a late event? Is glutamate toxicity an event that's late, but maybe occurs before oligodendroglial dysfunction? Or are they occurring at the same time? Or is axon transport also a mid-diseased event, but again, I'm making this up. Are nuclear pore defects an earlier event? By the way, we definitely think so. I won't have time to talk about that. Alyssa will talk about that at the Packard meeting. The other part of this kind of schema is like, well, so how much do each of these contribute to disease when you see a patient or an early disease? Maybe oligodendroglial dysfunction, beautifully shown in mouse models and maybe iPS cells, but maybe only counts for 10% of the injury. Maybe nuclear pore defects are 10% of the injury, but get magnified by downstream events. This combination of contribution and percent contribution, we have no knowledge on. We might if we knew the drugs were really powerful. For example, if I inhibited nuclear pore and I saw almost no disease, okay, that's a powerful pathway. But I think all of us at Know ALS know that we've yet to find a powerful intervention pathway at the time we use our drugs. It could be if we gave antisense to SOD1 patients when they're 10 years of age, they'll never get disease. We don't know yet. We don't know, even at 10, there's already an activation of some of these other pathways at a very small level, and they propagate after one another. No model has taught us this yet in a real way that's relevant to patients. By the way, each of these models, however, and these pathways have led to those drugs from preclinical research. Glutamate pathway led to riluzole, FDA approved. Led to tilampanol. Phase 2 was positive, phase 3 was negative. Ceftriaxone, I'll come back to in just a minute, phase 2 kind of looked positive, phase 3 negative. Mexiletine, or there are candidate drugs for connexins, and VEGF is an astroglial-based pathway. Oops, wow, I really blew that, sorry. Let's go back. Nope, got to do it this way. Keep doing that wrong, sorry. Oligodendroglia, we know there's metabolic support, but there's no real therapy for oligodendroglia. Nuclear pore biology, those studies are now underway. There's C9 ASOs, KPQ350 by Biogen affect nuclear transport. So a target. I'm not gonna tell you how good or bad these drugs are, but they're potential targets. Axon transport, we and Niels have seen multiple ideas about therapies that may affect axon growth or transport. An example of axon injury is the disarm-based drugs. Mitochondrial metabolism, there's metabolism in general that's been described in ALS as being abnormal. The CLEN compound being studied in the Healy platform, Amylyx drug may affect mitochondrial metabolism. Not a lot of good studies on those combinations. Nevertheless, it's possible. Radicava may be affecting mitochondrial metabolism. Again, a pathway identified. I think that's all I had for that. And potential drugs that have come to bear on those pathways. So I'm going to quickly go over three examples historically. So this is not new data, historically, of how preclinical research led to drug trials. One would be ceftriaxone, which is actually the largest academic clinical trial, and two gene therapies. I should point out, though, historically, until the last maybe 8 years, many of the drugs that we discovered in academics, if they're existing drugs, we ran the trials. That's flipped now, where most of the drugs that are coming to trial may be based on us as academics. I'm saying us, you may not all be academics, most of you are, but the companies who come in to design the trials and bring the drugs to us. And that, and two examples of that are really the gene therapies, which I'm going to review very quickly for you. This really began as a true coordinated effort to find drugs when NINDS, way back in the early 2000s, came up with a drug screening platform. By today, this is sort of old hat. It was not. It was completely novel back then. And they came to the academic community and said, by the way, we're going to give you 1,040 FDA-approved drugs, somewhat selected for those drugs that might get into the nervous system, but not necessarily. And you in the academic community have various assays that could be used to screen these drugs to see if the drugs are effective in your assays. And this was a really novel approach because we had to buy the drugs ourselves as a compound collection, which is now commonly available, was not then. And we came up with the different assays, we meaning there were different labs. There were eight assays that were relevant to ALS, a couple SOD1 toxicity, excitotoxicity, mitochondrial function, astrocyte function, SOD1 protein aggregation. But there are other diseases represented in the initial screen, Huntington's disease assays, Parkinson's, SMA, and Kennedy's disease. And we actually screened these drugs. I think we had 6 months to screen them. We had no idea of the results. We gave the results back to NINDS, and then they showed us the top to bottom hits. We didn't know what the hits were. Our assay was trying to fix a defect in astrocytes involving glutamate transporters, described in humans, described in animal models, and we were looking to increase the function of this glutamate transporter. Turns out, and this is the actual data from all of the assays, you can't read it, all the drugs. And what we learned was that in this assay, for what we were looking at, the top hit were cephalosporin, beta-lactam-based antibiotics. There were other hits, but these were multiple representations of the same class of drugs. In fact, they actually came up in several other assays, not just our assays, four other assays as these as top hits. In our system, which we published in Nature way back in 2005, it was a simple system. We screened for drugs who could just increase the protein and function expression of an astrocyte-specific protein, glutamate transporter. This was the screening assay. These were the actual hits, and the height of the column represented the actual protein that was made on what was known as a slot blot assay. And when we looked at the top hits, they were all family members of beta-lactam antibiotics, ampicillin, various cephalosporin antibiotics. And when we looked more closely, we saw that some of them really increased glutamate transport. And we began to focus on ceftriaxone because of all these antibiotics, most of them actually don't get through the blood-brain barrier. And if you're going to think eventually taking a drug back to patients, it's got to get to the brain. And we had a gene reporter mice. We treated the mouse with the ceftriaxone, beautifully increased the gene expression. We went eventually to SOD1 mice at the time. And we could show that this drug, in at the time, fairly large cohorts, at least 20 animals on drug compared to saline, and we increased survival, by no means a home run, but increasing glutamate transporters, both at this level and with a gene reporter, or actually functional protein, we saw that we increased. And this actually led to the clinical trial of ceftriaxone in patients. It was an unusual trial that Merit Sokovich put together at the time. It was a sort of a combination of a phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3. And the reason it was phase 1 is because we needed to use high doses of ceftriaxone, much higher than generally used by patients. Generally, patients would use up to 4 grams a day for CNS infections. 2 grams a day. We estimated based on our IC50 of activity, which was relatively low, was about 1 to 3 micromolar, not bad, but not in the nanomolar range for our target engagement, that we needed about 4 grams. And because of that, the FDA actually wanted some additional safety studies in animals, but they allowed us to do this, but really wanted a sort of a phase 1 followed by a phase 2. At phase 2, if things look promising, we go on to a phase 3. In reality, at the end of the phase 3, it was a failure, did not really increase survival. Or change ALS-FRS. We weren't using ALS-FRS as densely as we're using it now. That's the functional rating scale. But actually what was interesting at the phase 2 level, at that time point, there was a clear statistical significance in slowing disease that's shown here from our original abstract. But as we scaled up from 60, I can't remember the exact numbers, to 500 patients, we lost that statistical significance. So the drug was thought to be a failure. Turns out very recently, Ernest Frankel and his team at MIT have looked at this data, and they find that our responder group was really made up of multiple subsets of patients. And there very well may have been a subset of patients that actually had slowing of disease. But at the time, we lump all patients together. We had no way of separating. And although we thought we had a biomarker for that trial, the NIH wouldn't fund the biomarker to be tested in patients. So we were blindly giving the drug. In the end, it failed, although post hoc, with newer artificial intelligence approaches to looking at data, suggested there could have been a subset that was positive. In fact, Ernest's lab, looking at much larger data sets, up to 4,000 patients, have shown that there are many different courses of ALS patients. And we tend to make the mistake of assuming that the early slope, as we still use this in trials, might look like this. Patients can have very different slopes when you use these better integrative and analytics. And in the future, groups like Ernest, when they eventually publish these kinds of approaches, will help us better identify efficacies in subgroups. Okay, the next target, and I went in more depth for that, was really the SOD1 gene. And interventions of the SOD1 gene actually happened a long time ago. Remember, SOD1 gene mutations discovered by Tipu Sadiq and Bob Brown in 1992. By 1994, actually, our group at Hopkins, in collaboration with Bob Brown, had already developed antisense. Now, we weren't using it as a therapy at the time. We were really trying to understand the biology of SOD1, but we showed that we can use antisense to knock down SOD1, although in cultures that actually could be quite toxic. Parenthetically, when we contacted Ionis way back in 1995 about the possibility of moving this to models, by the way, this was published in 1994, but even before we had an SOD1 mouse, Ionis was not interested at that point in drug therapies for the CNS. By the way, back then Ionis was called ISIS, but after 9/11, they changed their name. We actually defined that antisense in multiple follow-on experiments could be a great CNS tool by 1999. In 2006, Richard Smith, Tim Miller, Bob Brown showed that antisense to SOD1 could be quite effective in changing neurodegeneration in the SOD1 mice, a perfect use of SOD1 antisense in the right preclinical model. Although that model may be useful for many other things, it's perfectly aligned to use antisense because that matches what occurs in patients. And then the first human trial of antisense for SOD1 began in 2013. Now, as you'll see, we learned recently that this was very effective. It began in 2013. That was the first trial. But what happened is when that trial was done, Ionis changed the backbone, the structure of the ASO, and everything had to be restarted. And that led to the Valor trial that was just published this year, run by Tim Miller, included multiple sites, including our site run by Nick and Merit Sokovich and others, showing that ASOs given to ALS SOD1 patients clearly could change the course of disease in this very aggressive form of the disease. And a phase 3 trial is now underway. This is a great example of preclinical discovery, the use of a model moving to to humans. Now, that took years to develop, but as many of you know, antisense is such a highly directed and well-worked out therapy that the next story is a much faster story. Again, upstream targets. The next and the last story of this is the C9 story. The C9 mutation discovered by Rosa Rademacher and Brian Trainer in 2011. By 2013, we already had developed antisense to C9. And this was first used now, not in a mouse model, because there were no mouse models in the early years. It was very complicated to build a C9 mouse, but by then we already had a brand new platform to switch to, iPS cells. And Chris Donnelly showed that the C9 antisense, our molecules, and those actually eventually provided by Ionis, were quite effective in lowering the RNA, eventually later lowering dipeptides, and could show they could mitigate cell toxicity. That was 2013. By 2016, Clotilde and Don Cleveland showed in now a newly generated C9 back mouse, again, the same antisense could lower dipeptide repeats and lower RNA foci. That mice doesn't develop any dramatic neurodegeneration. And then more recently, Tanya Gendron showed that actually in patients, those dipeptides could be lowered, again, now beautifully done by Lindsay Hayes in a dose-dependent fashion with the antisense oligonucleotides. We got a timeline for what that takes. And we also learned, and I think I have a slide for this, that patients have quite elevated dipeptide repeats. Now, although there's a lot of controversy as to whether dipeptide repeats at human levels are toxic, they're a fantastic biomarker. And this was important because as we move from our preclinical models, we actually learned in patients that not only do our preclinical models have those dipeptides, but patients have them. It's, you can see, quite variable, although non-C9 patients don't have them. And the idea that they're not really toxic is shown here, that the levels are quite elevated, well in advance of disease. They don't change with the disease. And there's no relationship between the levels of dipeptides and the severity of disease, but they are a great marker for showing if your therapy is working. So first in man phase 1 trials are now underway, 2019 for C9. It's a sense anti sense molecule. It's not targeting the antisense strand, and that may be important. To date, there have been no publications on using antisense targeting the antisense strand, and the antisense strand might turn out to be quite important. We don't know yet. Our own lab and unpublished data knows that the antisense RNA is quite toxic. We've actually added it in, and we know that antisense ASOs can be quite protective against certain cellular pathways. Nevertheless, we're now underway using the antisense to the sense strand. We're all hopeful we'll change the course of the disease. That trial is now well underway in multiple different doses. We're now about to start the highest dose level in patients. This is an international trial. But the point of this actually is that we move very fast from from preclinical work to trials using these newer models like iPS cells and antisense approaches. Last few minutes, I'm going to switch gears. So those have been different models about what the platforms are for drug discovery, and a couple examples of how we've done this in academics. Some academics have sort of taken on the next realm. So most of us end with a target. We go to companies. Antisense is a great example. We go to the ASO companies, say, can you give us your best ASO? We tend not to develop in a lab. But there are now many academic labs that can do drug discovery beyond the existing drugs on the shelf. An example of that is the group that we set up at Hopkins, run by Barb Slusher, started about a decade ago. And to do this, we really needed an experienced drug discovery team. We were able to bring them in, a team that actually knows drug discovery. Again, most of us know how to build pathways, but we're not really drug discovery experts. If you want to move that entire pathway, you've got to bring that team in. And there's actually examples very recently of this kind of pure academic discovery in FDA-approved drugs. So an example of this was a team was brought in. They came to Johns Hopkins. We, and by the way, this could be any of your own universities. You don't have to be at Hopkins. We all have the faculty expertise at drug pathways, the target identification, but a drug discovery team, normally what's in pharma, but can be done with the right experts, can determine if can screen for the small molecules, can determine if it's a true druggable target, can do the high throughput screens, can optimize the 20 odd molecules down to one, can do the pharmacokinetics and eventually select the right drug. And eventually you come back to the clinical expertise to carry out the appropriate clinical trials. An example of that really as a team under one roof, here is an example here at Hopkins, but I have to tell you, this does exist at the universities, Vanderbilt, UCSF, Penn, all have these kinds of teams. You've got a team that know medicinal chemistry. When we started, we had a team of 20 medicinal chemists. That's certainly small by pharma standards, but because this team was so long embedded in pharmaceutical development, we now have a team of 600 medicinal chemists through a collaboration in Prague. And so that's bigger than most pharma. So they find the right drug, they give it back to us to optimize, the hit to lead optimization, developing the right druggable assays, optimizing drug design, doing in vivo pharmacology as shown here, because once you have the molecule, you've got to understand its distribution, whether you can give it orally, IV, subcutaneously, turn to the academics for animal models, optimize drug screening assays, and of course, drug metabolism. This is something most of us don't do, but having a team internally, you really can get a drug from the early stages that we do to truly an IND-ready drug. This has actually happened already here. This is a list of drugs. Although this team was brought in for CNS drug discovery, they quickly learned by being in a medical center, they can develop drugs for many other medical targets. And these are actually the different drugs that they developed. By having the experienced team, you can have a far better collaboration with pharma. These are just some of the companies that the team internally has collaborated with. You can collaborate with venture investments to bring in additional funds beyond NIH dollars. And most importantly, you can spin out new biotechs to truly bring the drugs to patients. And this team at Hopkins has already spun out 5 biotech companies. I can tell you, unfortunately, none of these are ALS oriented though. When they started, there was actually very little coordination for academic drug discovery, and Barb Slusher and then others around the country that were leading some of the units began to really expand on this. 1990, there were only a handful of drug discovery units. By 2002, a few more. In 2018, there are more than 100 drug discovery units in academics around the country. Some are very small, some are quite large. And so academic drug discovery can occur. And keep in mind that 80% of new drug targets come from academics. You can develop great partnerships, and these partnerships with pharma have increased dramatically in the last decade. So there's opportunities to really move your research to pharma. And importantly, the drugs that are, and the collaborations between academic and pharma, as shown here, have dramatically increased over the last few years. This is already an outdated slide. Much of the early stage company formations, that is new drugs, are really coming from academic discovery. And as shown here, there's a good chunk of this, although cancer is still the bulk of it. Neurology represents a large number of new companies that are based on academic discoveries, spinning out new companies, or not shown here, licensing opportunities. I'll skip this slide. Finally, before I end, I should point out that this is an expensive process. We at the university level, we fund our research largely through NIH grants, if nonprofits to some extent come in. And that's essentially a community support, that is taxes support most of what we do. There's a lot of high risk in what we do in truly getting drugs to patients. There can be biotech startups. Some of this money comes from pharma. Most of it comes from venture, from pharma or VCs. Again, there still tends to be somewhat of a high risk. Although once you have promising medicines, you may get additional investors, private or pharmaceutical companies that come in, begin to take those drugs. This can happen in academics, also can happen when you spin out companies. You have the clinical trials, the companies make a ton of money. You eventually get a new drug on the market from them, and the companies charge a bunch of money, which we pay for again. So we tend to pay at the beginning and we tend to pay at the end as well. Okay, just to end, I want to point out that, and since I really can't cover all of the new pathways, there are certainly some exciting new pathways coming up that are becoming druggable with drug candidates being brought up by biotech from our preclinical research. And when I say our, I really do constantly refer to our academic labs. One, autophagy. TBK1, there's already thoughts about a gene therapy targeting this pathway. Stress-based pathways are burgeoning. There's a whole new series of approaches. Liquid phase transitions, phenomenal science, really quite interesting science. Sorry, I'm near the ER, that's why you hear the ambulance. Literally yesterday or 2 days ago, Nature Biotech, there's an article about how three new companies were started in the last year or so based on phase transitions with more than $300 million in investments. DuPont and Phase are a couple of examples. Now, this is really early research. As a neurologist, I'm not entirely sure how we'll develop drugs around this or the specificity, but I don't know that. And the science around this is fascinating. The money's there to work on developing those drugs. We'll just see what comes out of that. ER stress is of great interest by a number of certainly labs, but have now moved to companies. IF2B activators, AbbVie and Calico are working already towards a phase one trial. Disaggregases with AstraZeneca. Inhibitors of RNA aggregation, again, an important target. Ataxin-2, which I could have put in an earlier slide, Biogen is now just started an Ataxin-2 antisense trial. There are already early drugs targeting nuclear pore biology. The Karyoform drug licensed in by Biogen was being studied by Biogen. There are new ideas you'll hear about in a couple of weeks from Alyssa about an SCORE3 pathway. In the last minute, how do we expand that base of research to understand what are pathways in sporadic ALS? Much of what we've done comes from our familial models. There are no models of sporadic ALS in mouse. We don't know what causes sporadic ALS. And to address this, we began a program called Answer ALS, really built on building a data set and models that a worldwide community can use. And the point of this is that we know that when we have a series of patients, we can start with cancer that have all different reasons, they have breast cancer or prostate cancer or melanoma, we give them all the same drug. We often have subsets of patients that have no benefit whatsoever. But when we can identify the subsets of patients and target them appropriately with the right drug for the right pathway for that patient, that pathway may be based on a biopsy in cancer, typically not in neurologic diseases, but some fluid biomarkers in patients, maybe culturing their iPS cells. We can begin to identify subsets of patients and with the right tools, find the right drugs for those patients. And to do that, many of you may know, we started Answer ALS. We know there are multiple pathways that underlie ALS, if not from looking at different autopsy materials or different rodent, fly, fish models, but we really don't know what's going on in sporadic. And Answer ALS was a program to enroll 1,000 or more sporadic ALS patients, a handful of familial as well, at multiple clinics around the country, build those iPS cells that have now become, we'll call it the second generation ALS platform for finding drugs, do whole genome sequencing on all of those patients, convert those iPS cells to spinal neurons and interneurons, and then do a complete omics analysis, proteome, epigenome, RNA-seq, and all of that data, the clinical data and the omics data stored in the cloud for anyone to use and to begin to integrate. It's about 6 billion data points per patient. Every patient also has longitudinal biofluids, so you could go back and either identify the pathway from the omics analysis, go back to those patients' iPS cells to test it. We even have autopsies, go back to the autopsies, or check the biofluids. That data is now fully accessible for free to the worldwide community. We just released a portal with the help of Microsoft. This portal was identifiable through Answer ALS. You can do a Google search, find it. You can log on, you can request the data, and there's multiple different filters, age of patients, different clinical indices, different mutations. You can download the proteome data. You can download the RNA-seq data. Of course, you can download the clinical data. And very importantly, you can order the iPS cells that match those patients. And sometime in the near future, we'll actually have an extensive autopsy bank on this as well. So this is a new tool to help you identify subgroups of patients, and the tools are then available for you to begin to test those hypotheses. And in the last minute, so that is sort of what I consider one future for preclinical discovery for sporadic as well as familial ALS. One of the things you have to think about to end is that as your individual labs think you have a pathway, maybe you've discovered a drug, you got to think about protecting it if that's what you want to do. And that means submitting a patent. You have to be aware of rules around patents. You have to be aware that if you present your science and you haven't put a patent in, your patent becomes ineligible for patenting because you've now told the world and it becomes common knowledge. The same applies to a published manuscript. You have to think about these issues. You can put your data in government grants because government grants don't obviate a patent. You can actually put your preliminary data in a patent, and that's called a provisional patent. And you have 1 year to really fill out the rest of the data. And it's actually okay to try to patent existing drugs, which is often referred to as repurposing, although to be fair, is really low yield. Most companies are not gonna wanna license an existing drug. You may think you have great protection. What you often wanna do is if you have existing drugs that look interesting, eventually build better new molecules, what are known as NCEs, new chemical entities around those drugs. For that, you need a drug discovery team. Nevertheless, if you have a pathway or a drug and you want to interact with companies, you also want to think about the legal ramifications. And often that means a non-disclosure agreement. And that should be a one-way, not a two-way. And I can have further discussions if you'd like in the future. But at this point, I'm going to end my talk and I'll entertain any questions or you'll go on to do other things. I want to remind all of you, and you'll hear about this, the Packard meeting is coming up in about a month. You should all have notices about that. And of course, we want you all to pay attention to these monthly ALS clinical series as well. Thanks.
Thanks, Jeff.